Hello everyone. In the previous chapter, we saw the settings specific to videos. In this chapter, we will see what the settings are for in the section, Common Parameters. As the title says, these settings are the same for all item types, but, as always, they apply to each one independently. You will also see that they will be very useful when creating advanced animations. Let's see this. Open your program and insert an empty view. Its duration and transition don't matter in this chapter, so leave them at their default values. Select your view and open the editor, Objects and Animations. As I told you in the introduction, the common commands are the same for all types of elements, but to see the effects we must use a visible element, such as a photo, because, on a frame or a mask empty, since by default they are invisible, we would not see the effects, even if they will indeed be applied to them. So add an image in your montage. To do this, as seen previously, you have the command icon, Add Image, in the upper banner, but also, if you right-click in the Elements area, in the contextual menu that opens, you also have all the commands for adding an element, plus many others that will be very useful to us in the future. Alright, so let's add an image. Its format and size don't matter for the common parameters. Now, and depending on your screen resolution, it is very likely that they will not appear, in whole or in part, so use the vertical scroll bar to scroll this tab up, in order to see all of the different parameters. The submenu, Common, is made up of 5 checkboxes, plus 2 adjustable commands. A third will be available if you check the box, Shadow. Let's take them in order. First, we have the option, Do not select on click, and it is disabled by default. This option allows you, when activated, to deactivate the selection of the element by clicking in the view area of your montage. Indeed, for the moment, normally as you have just added an image, it is selected in the list of elements, and, in your view, you can see it thanks to the yellow frame, which surrounds it. Click in the empty part of the list of elements, and now nothing is selected, the yellow frame has also disappeared. If you click on your image in the view area, it will be selected again. Well, now activate the command, Do not select on click, then, click in the empty part of the list of elements to deselect your image. Now, if you click on your image, it will no longer be selected. To re-select it, you will have to click on its name in the list of elements. In fact, this command is of no use during the creation to the view of your assembly. It is on the other hand, very useful during complex assembly, with many elements, which often overlap, and therefore, this allows you to modify your elements on view, in the viewing area, even if it is covered by another, provided that this other has the function. Do not select on click, activated. For now, uncheck this option, and see the following 2 commands, Show Front, and Show Back. Which, are they of origin, activated. These 2 options will allow you to define which faces of your element will be visible. To better understand its scope, let's give our image a rotation of 360 degrees, that is to say a complete turn, on its vertical axis and this, over the duration of our view. Go to the tab, Animation, and, our first key being already placed, put the time at the end of view, then, click on the plus to add a second key to this time. Then, activate the command. Rotation, and give the value, 360 to the Y Greek axis. Now, if we play our animation, we will see alternately the 2 faces of our image. Return to the tab, Properties, then uncheck the box, Display the back. Let's play our animation again, and we see that the backside of our image is no longer displayed during the rotation. Let's now invert the active faces and check the command. Display the front and check the command. Show the back. Now, during our animation, only the backside of our image will be displayed. If we uncheck both options, well, our image will be invisible, whatever its rotation, which is therefore, in principle, never used, because what would be the point of putting an invisible element in our montage? In short, you will see that these two commands will be very useful when animating compound objects, such as cubes, tubes, or even when simply rotating elements. The fourth command, hide child, will only be useful when you create animations with linked elements. It allows you to automatically assign the commands, display the front, and display the back, to the elements that will be linked to the one with this active option. It is still a little early in our tutorials to see the full scope of this, and we will come back to this in the chapter devoted to the link between objects and elements. The following command, shadow, allows you, when you activate it, to place a shadow effect under your image. To see the scope, we have to reduce the size of our image, and therefore, in the tab, animation, set its size to 80% on both axes. Good, but by default our wallpaper is black, and it will be difficult to see a shadow there. So right-click in the empty area of the list of elements, and click on Add a Rectangle. This one being placed in front of our image, use the key combination Shift plus Control plus Page Down to move our rectangle down in the list, and therefore in second position. Return to the tab Properties, select the image in the list of elements, and check the command Shadow. Now, our shadow is clearly visible, and the command Parameters is active. Click on it to open its control window. This is made up of controls allowing you to adjust the shadow cast by the object to your liking. In order, we have the color, which, by clicking in its intended area, allows you to change the color of the shadow using the program's color menu. By default, black is used. Its opacity, and therefore, the intensity of the drop shadow, by default it is at 59%, and the higher it is, the more intense the shadow will be, hiding the elements behind it. The angle allows you to define where the light comes from in your montage, and therefore, to place the shadow according to it. By default, the light is placed at the top left, so your shadow will be shifted down and to the right. The distance allows you to define the angle formed between the light source and your assembly. The greater this one will be, the greater the offset of your shadow will also be, and, at zero, for any angle, your shadow will be centered in relation to your image, as if the light were coming directly in front of it. The size allows you to enlarge the shadow, as if bringing the light source closer. The next drop-down menu allows you to define a type of shadow. By default, it is on linear. I'm not going to detail them all, it will be much easier for you to see for yourself by testing the different types of shadows available. The command Shadow Models allows you to save the different models that you create, and, later, to be able to reuse these models directly, without having to redefine all their parameters. Finally, you have the checks. Shadow for 3D mode. Check this command if you use animation with 3D rotations. This will force the program to place your shadow always behind the element, and correctly following its displacements and rotations. As for most pop-up windows, you must click on Validate to apply your transformations, and if you click on Cancel or On the closing cross of the window, your modifications will be ignored, and the element will keep the values before opening the edit window. The following command, mode, allows you to adjust the size of your image in relation to the view. Yes, a bit like the aspect crop we saw previously, but unlike the aspect crop, this command will allow your image to perfectly cover the visible area, but without cutting it. In concrete terms, let's empty our view and insert an image in portrait format. If we use the function aspect crop in 16:9 format, and we use an image of a standing person, well, we only see their belly. On the other hand, now let's use the command mode with the option cover the view. Yes, we have the same result, but go to the tab animation and move the image on its aggregate axis, and now we can see the part of it that interests us, say, the head. This command is more useful for fixed elements, because, for moving elements, of which you should only see part of them, I advise you to use the command trim image to select the part of it that interests you. There remains the last command, interval. This double command will allow us to define when our element will be visible on the screen. This will be visible between its start and end times, expressed in milliseconds. By default, the first start is at 0, that is at the start of your view, and the second at the total duration of your view. Here we have 5000, because by default, our view is 5 seconds, which gives us 5000 in milliseconds. This command will also be very useful for us during 3D animations, where certain objects will be at times in front, and at other times, behind other elements, and, thanks to this command, this will avoid us having to add lots of animation keys. We will come back to this in due course. Here, we have just reviewed the different common parameters, and, in the next chapter, we will be able to start our first assemblies, and, above all, see what these famous frames can be used for. Thank you for your attention, and see you soon in the rest of these tutorials dedicated to the Private AV Studio 10 Pro program. Katerina and Patrick.